Namaskar. So my dear counselors, learners and other practitioners in ODL system, we are very happy that Professor B. Venkaiah, the Vice Chancellor of Krishna University, Andhra Pradesh, he is with us.
Namaskar.
Actually, Professor Venkaiah spent about 30 years of his career in open and distance learning education, particularly in the university in Hyderabad, Dr. Ambedkar Open University. And currently, he is the Vice Chancellor in the Krishna University, Andhra Pradesh. And besides that, he is an expert in ODL and also a management guru. So, we welcome you to this studio, sir.
Thank you, sir. Thank
you. And we take advantage of your visit to this university because you have been visiting twice in the month of April as well as this month as a external verifier of Commonwealth of Learning for the colloquium practice doing by this university. And we take advantage of your presence in the university, and we thought that it is better to have some interaction with the ODL system as well, more particularly on open educational resources. Basically, what I see that this, what is the basic philosophy of ODL? Particularly, we have sometimes some confusion among the learners of this university as well as counselors. They might need to have some clarification on the very philosophy of ODL.
You are quite aware, being the leader of open distance learning in this part of the country, serving the cause of higher education through distance mode, sir.
Yes.
And well, open distance learning is a philosophy essentially meant for democratizing higher education.
Yes.
It is education for the people, of the people and by the people, like to define democracy.
Yes.
You know, in countries like India, developing countries of like India, the demand for higher education is more, whereas the conventional universities are not able to meet the demand.
Exactly.
And hence, we are not able to provide higher education to the needy, who aspire to improve their qualifications academically.
Mm-hmm.
Our gross enrollment ratio today in the country is 18.8. which is less than the world average.
Yes.
And in developed countries, it is of the order of 40-45%, 50% also in some countries.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas in our country, it is 18.8 and we are aiming to increase it to 30%.
By the end of 2020.
And by 2017, we wanted to increase it to 25%.
Yes.
This is the target.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, distance education is a great opportunity to the seekers of higher education, particularly those who are underserved,
yes,
underprivileged, poor segments of the population, rural people,
yes,
people residing in hilly area, tribal areas, etc., because they do not have access, as they are not financially sound to meet the expenditure incidental to higher education system in the conventional mode.
Basically, that one of the very important contribution of the ODL, as I understand, that the low-cost education, and it is giving access to almost all sections of the society.
Yes. You see, the philosophy is, to say in a few words, education for all.
Yes.
Education for all. In the sense that those who cannot afford conventional education can seek education through distance mode, because the cost of distance education graduate, that is to produce a graduate through distance education mode, it costs only 1/3 of the conventional mode of education.
Yes.
And for example, we are charging in India, in different open universities, for a bachelor's program, annual fee ranges between 1000 to 1500.
Yes.
That it means in about 5000 rupees, a person is able to get the graduation degree, and we are providing tuition, we are providing this print material, self-learning materials, we are providing all the learner support required, and that is the benefit of open distance education.
Yes.
It is to reach the unreached.
Exactly.
And to shift education from classes to masses, and to de-elitize higher education.
Yes.
And moreover, It is an opportunity. There is no barrier with regard to age. There is no compulsion that they should attend the tutorials or our counseling sessions.
Yes.
And hence, the system is flexible, open admission policy. Formal education is not required.
Yes.
In a conventional institution, if a student wants to join bachelor's degree, he has to pass plus two level or intermediate course. But here, in open education system, we provide a bridge course for the bachelor's program for 1 year or 6 months. In your university, in Assam, in KK Hande, it is 1 year. In IGNOW, it is 6 months.
Yes.
And in some universities, it is not there also.
Mm-hmm.
They conduct an entrance test, and based on the qualification obtained in the entrance test, admissions are given. It means those who failed 7th class, 8th class, 10th class, intermediate,
they get an opportunity.
They have an opportunity to pursue their higher education, bachelor's degree and PG education. It is a great opportunity.
Yes.
This is how the philosophy is to serve the needy.
Exactly.
To provide education at an affordable cost.
Yes.
To reach the unreached and the poorest of the poor in terms of providing education. To create an opportunity to in-service people to continue their education.
Even housewives.
While doing the job. Housewives. And everybody, even construction workers are there. Workers related to different spheres of life. They are our students.
Now, in our university, for example, this year, one gentleman of 77 years old has taken admission in the first year's first semester. So, this is a great opportunity for such a person for lifelong learning.
In a way, it is realizing the self-potential.
Exactly.
It is it is the dream of an a person who retired about 15, 17 years ago, wants to do a bachelor's program or PG program.
Yes.
It is engaging himself in a fruitful activity of knowledge gain, of spending his time productively.
Yes. Second, another point that in the ODL philosophy, we talk about 3A. It's education for anyone, anywhere, and anytime.
Anytime.
So in this case, to give support to this 3A, I think the information and communication technology is a must.
Yeah,
what do you think about that system?
No, ICT has totally revolutionized the teaching learning process.
Exactly.
It is a total transformation that has come about in the education front.
Mm-hmm.
If we analyze the kind of trends that have taken place in the past 1.5 decades in the higher education sector, phenomenal.
Mm.
See, for example, now we talk about virtual library, virtual convocation, virtual conference, virtual classroom.
Yes.
These are the concepts that we are talking about.
Mm-hmm.
It means that the technology is able to provide education to farthest places. Students need not come to the institution, and it is what is called distributed learning.
Yes.
That we can telecast our lessons through satellite, telecast our lessons through Doordarshan channel, and also we can provide standalone audio CDs and DVDs, and in addition to print materials, we can use electronic media and realize the potential of electronic media in taking education to the learners.
Yes.
No, for example, KK Handik State Open University having a community radio is an example of how it is serving.
Yes.
Not only that, the lessons, radio lessons broadcast through community radio are streamed on internet is a great opportunity. That is, it is not only for the learners of this university, that also the general public can access, and it is a social cause that we are serving.
Now, even I believe even from your university, the learner can have the community radio through internet.
It is possible.
Yes.
Not only here, all over the world,
through
internet, the programs of this university can be heard by anybody in the world.
Yes.
In fact, that is an example of open education resource.
Again, I tell you, say, we have the headquarters in Guwahati. We have study centers, about 260 study centers spread all over Assam. Now, what we can do with the age of technology, of course, we have to make more infrastructure. That centrally, we can give lectures on certain topics in the headquarters, and that can be telecast, maybe offline or online,
Yes.
We can send you to the study centers, and all the learners will be benefited from the
lectures
given by the expert in the centrally.
Yeah, the lessons, the video lessons we call it, produced in this studio can be developed into DVDs, and standalone DVDs can be given to study centers where students can watch them at their convenience.
Exactly.
And we can give a DVD to students. These days DVDs are not expensive.
Exactly.
We can also give 4 or 5 lessons of a particular academic program can be given in the form of a DVD. Students can watch the programs and learn the course when they want to do. It's convenience to them.
Yes.
Not only our students, when we are giving to the study center coordinator, the students of that college, regular students, also can get the benefit of it.
Yes.
That is the great potential. Moreover, that not only the experts available locally or nationally, even the international experts, when they visit our university,
exactly,
we can record the lesson, their views on a particular subject area, and that can be given.
Yes.
It means the experts available all over the world in a particular branch of knowledge can be made available to different groups of students.
Yes. Another recent development in the ODL system, you might be, because you might be knowing, and you are very much involved in the whole system, that whatever the study material we prepare, normally the system was five years back, it is my own property, it is your own property. Now it has been globalized, the educational resources have been globalized. Now the concept of open educational resources. So can you just give more detail about that to my learners and the...
Just now we talked about ICT.
Yes.
ICT revolutionized the teaching learning process.
Yes.
Revolutionized the administrative system,
yes,
revolutionized the student evaluation system, and it has touched upon every area: teaching, learning, evaluation, administration, research.
Mm-hmm.
This is how ICT had an impact, and it will have amazing impact in the years ahead.
Yes.
Now, open education resources is one of the benefit of the ICT being available to us as teachers. What do we mean by these open education resources? To have the genesis of open education resources,
yes,
it is about 20 years old a concept.
Mm-hmm.
That we have been availing open education resources. But the momentum came from 2002.
Yes, only the last few years.
Yeah, last one decade. In 2002, UNESCO organized a conference where they adopted the concept of open educational resources. What do we mean by that? That the institutions shall be in a position to give copyright to anybody to use the material for teaching, research, and any other purpose other than commercial use.
Exactly.
This is the concept of open education resources. It means open education resources can be accessed, used
by anyone,
customized, translated and localized by anyone. Let him be a teacher, a researcher, a student, a person from the general public.
But can anyone copy exactly line by line from particular area of work?
Yes, it is like this.
There is no such bar.
No, there is no such bar at all. Unless it is put to commercial use, there is no bar.
Yes, yes.
It is for academic purpose. It is for knowledge generation. It is for knowledge dissemination.
Mm-hmm.
It is for the benefit of everybody. The philosophy here is, knowledge is the commonwealth of humankind.
Exactly.
It must be made available to all the human beings.
So the benefit goes to everyone.
Everybody. Now, for example,
yes,
I will give a couple of practices. There is one Asia E University, Asia Electronic University, located in Malaysia.
Yes.
The university does not produce any materials.
Mm-hmm.
All their programs are based on open educational resources. They are digital learning resources used for e-learning purpose by the university.
Yes.
And they define the curriculum, and for that curriculum they search from the web. The open education resources which are copy left.
Yes.
Open education resources are copy left.
Yes.
Not copyrighted.
Yes, copy left.
Let's say the copy is left out to be used by anybody. So Asia E University is taking materials available from the web under open education resources, and giving the materials to the students and testing them.
Yes.
They define the curriculum, develop the curriculum, syllabus, and then and the materials are identified and borrowed and supplied.
So the relevant materials have been collected.
Relevant materials collected and from OER and other sources, and then where they are freely available, mm-hmm. and they are given to the students, and they are offering the e-learning courses. It is called, that is why of late we are hearing OER based e-learning.
Yes.
OER based e-learning programs.
Mm-hmm.
That is how the new concept are.
Now, recently,
similarly,
yes.
in Athabasca University, Canada,
yes.
there was a directive from the university that if quality open education resources are available in a particular branch of knowledge, in a particular program or course, such materials need not be developed.
Yes.
And then other materials which are not available in the OER front may be developed. However, quality will be controlled by the university.
Yes. So recently, Professor Venkaiah, that our university has got a license from Creative Commons. That is also some form of open educational resources. So actually, we can adopt their resources. Our resources can be adopted by others. So that is a great advantage, not only for us, but for the other open distance learning educational system also.
Yeah, here. Any country has its own option,
yes.
of getting licensed,
yes.
To see that their materials are given. But at world level, the famous licensing framework is Creative Commons.
Yes.
I am sure that this university under your leadership has taken membership in Creative Commons.
Yes.
It's a great cause. It's mm-hmm. a great cause that you are joining the movement of open education resources and helping the society
as well as getting ourselves benefited. Now in 2012 UNESCO organized that World OER meetings, that congress. So I think that can you also enlighten us about system?
See, it is like this. In June 2002 the first initiative was made by
UNESCO.
They, as a decennial event, they organized World OER Congress at UNESCO,
mm-hmm.
World OER Congress was held at UNESCO. There, they adopted some policies,
mm-hmm.
after thorough deliberations, and then some promotional measures were given to government, teachers, and government institutions and individual teachers.
Mm-hmm.
It means that UNESCO has identified at the Congress that there is a need for the government, institutions and individuals to play a greater role in the movement of open education resources.
Yes.
These policies include promotion of, they have given different 8 recommendations to each of these three
mm-hmm.
groups. That is governments across the countries, governments and the institutions, all higher education institutions. And the third one is in teachers working in different education institutions.
Mm-hmm.
And moreover, here generally the common policy measures they suggested to promote OER are promotion of OERs as a policy,
uh-huh.
at every level.
Yes.
Digitizing the learning resources. Adopting OER as a policy.
Yes.
Funding development and creation of open education resources, and leaving the copyright by the individuals on the research works they have done.
Yes.
And institutions encouraging professional development among the teachers towards developing skills of OER.
Mm-hmm.
These are important promotional measures that UNESCO Congress organized. Given to governments and also governments were advised to reduce the gap of digital divide,
exactly.
to enhance the bandwidth, to make digital learning resources available, and to fund creation and development of OERs in a big way.
Yes. No, in fact, we are also contributing at least to a little extent to the development of OER in the sense that whatever the material we have, that printing material, we have digitalized it, and whatever the audiovisual material, audio material we have it, we have put in the UTIP. And so this is linked from the website of the university. So we have a university own open access resource link, and anybody, any learner, any counselor, they go to the website of the university and they get the link to get our study materials, both in the electronic form as well as in audiovisual format. So this this actually it is not a great thing we are doing, but we are just initiating process. Of
I would say in India,
yes,
you are doing really a great job.
Mm-hmm.
Because with 7 years old experience, you are able to create internet radio.
Yes.
And then introduce YouTube and loading the videos there,
video,
audios
audio,
there.
Yes.
And I know that I think I visited your YouTube also.
Mm-hmm.
And then watched some of the programs recorded by you earlier also on the same kind of topics.
Mm-hmm.
And there are 79 videos already available on the YouTube of
university.
Yes. It's not a small job.
Mm-hmm.
It's not a small job. It's a great service. Similarly, audios, about 200 audio CDs are there. And then they're all wonderful services. They're all wonderful services that the university is rendering to the...
Not only
to the learners, but also beyond the...
Anybody can use it.
Beyond
anybody.
The learner groups.
Yes, any public can use
it.
So another clarification, I just want to know it, because many people, many counselors, students have some confusion regarding OER and OA. Open education resources and open access.
Maybe I would like to drop on this. Number one, open education resources as a movement has taken place in the past one decade.
Mm-hmm.
Hewlett and Flora, William and Flora Hewlett Foundation gave lot of funding to MIT.
Yes.
MIT. And MIT used that fund to develop open education resources under the project Open Courseware. And all the programs on offer on campus in MIT, the OER have been developed.
Yes.
And they are available under Open Courseware project.
Mm.
Similarly, with UNESCO initiative, Commonwealth of Learning initiative, and then MIT initiative, UKOU initiative, there is a lot of movement that has come about.
Mm-hmm.
Even in India, we are developing open education resources. BITS is doing, MPTEL is there, and
yes,
several other institutions like KK Handik State Open University are in their own modest way contributing the material. IGNO has contributed. This is how the movement has come about. So, normally this is through, the purpose is, the materials developed through funding have been made available till now.
Yes.
Now, in the recent past, we have been seeing institutions spending money and making the materials, learning materials or knowledge resources available in the public domain for free use.
Yes.
That is OER. Open access is also more than a decade old. In 2001 at Budapest, there was a conference held.
Yes.
And Budapest Initiative, it is called. Budapest Open Access Initiative was the concept. BOAI it is called in 2002.
Mm-hmm.
This open access refers to open access to the scientific information which is based on research results.
Yes.
The purpose here is science journals are very expensive. Science information is not available.
Yes.
And hence there was an initiative that the public funded scientific research or any other research for that matter which is carried out with the public funds must be made available freely to the public.
Yes.
That is open access. Open access refers to open access of the research results supported essentially by the public funds.
Yes.
That is open access.
Yes.
You see, several journals are available on open access policy today. It is initiated by the Budapest.
No, what one thing that Professor Venkaiah. So, that the teachers have a great role to play in the ODL system as well as in the conventional system also. Now, what can be the contribution made by the teachers, basically teachers, counselors, towards the development or use of the OER? And okay. also, how can the student directly get benefit?
Yeah. See, as ODL teachers, we have a greater role. Number one is, first, we must be creators of OER.
Yes.
We must be researchers on OER. We must give copyright of our materials which we did research on our own, yes. without any even funding. Okay? And we must be able to bring awareness among the public and particularly our counselors and learners about the availability of great resources called open educational resources.
Yes.
It means that a teacher can do research, can develop material, can give the copyright, can organize training programs for the benefit of everybody to bring about awareness among the counselors and learners particularly. And any other person for that matter. Counselors and learners shall make use of this wonderful resource.
Yes.
How? We must be able to train our counselors and let them know that these are the wonderful resources, knowledge resources, amazing wealth today we have on the net.
Yes.
And this wealth of knowledge is available free of cost. So counselors must be informed of this. Generally, conventional institutions, teachers do not know that there are resources like that.
Exactly.
Not many of them know. And some of them might know, but several of them do not know.
Yes.
So there is a need to bring awareness among the counselors first who are teaching our courses. For example, close to 3,000 counselors are working in this university. All of them must be informed about the availability of the open access and open education resources for the benefit of the learners. They must in turn inform the learners,
yes.
that in their subject area, so and so links are available. And if you go to MIT website, you have. Otherwise, you can go to Open Courseware Project directly. There are materials available.
Yes.
And if you go to NPTEL, there are materials available. This kind of information is to be given to the students, and the students must be able to make use of these resources.
Yes.
Not only that. As a university, through our newsletters, through our video lessons,
yes.
through our community radio, we must be able to let our students know that there are sources of knowledge available in different subject area. You take any subject, there are materials available.
Mm-hmm.
You take education, there are pharmacy, there are computer science, there are many management, there are, and even English and humanities and other subjects,
yes.
social sciences. Regardless of the type of program, the materials are available. Okay. You have to choose from the web. That is the thing.
Yes, sir. Being an expert in the ODL system, working for about 30 years in Hyderabad, Dr. Ambedkar University, I just want to request you to just give some advice to the learners and the counselors of these universities through this audiovisual program. What should be the basic responsibilities of the counselors? And because sometimes it happens that the learners think that they need not go to the study centers even on the weekly counseling day. And sometimes the learners sometimes find that the study centers may not be working properly. And in that case, then it may be disincentive to them. So in this case, what can be done by the study centers, counselors, study center in charge, then the coordinators, and also what will be your suggestion to the learners?
Okay. Now, I keep reiterating this statement that in open universities and distance education institutions, every person working in the university, at the headquarter, at the study center, at regional center, every person is a public relations person.
Exactly.
In the sense that he must have empathy towards students.
Yes.
He must be courteous. He must be encouraging. He must be patting. These are the, or she must be. He or she.
Now, even a clerical level person who is working in a study centers or in the university, he must have the same type of philosophy.
Yes. Very, very important. They must internalize distance education system as a philosophy,
yes.
as a value. And they have a greater role. For example, in our study center, a clerk is as much important as the coordinator.
Exactly.
Because some information he can give. So, first important thing is study center head, that is coordinator, counselors, and study center, I mean university headquarters staff, all of them must know the academic regulations, examination system regulations, general information about admission process, examination processes, etc. Total and complete knowledge of the academic and other regulations is the first essential factor, first essential thing that they should have. That is one. Mm-hmm. So, knowledge of the university system, university regulations, university processes, etc. And academic programs on offer. This is the first thing. Second thing is, they must be cordial and kind enough to understand the problems of the students.
Yes.
As counselors, I keep on saying, there is famous theory called Rogers Wage Theory.
Yes.
This wage refers to W-A-G-E, each word standing for a particular purpose, particular meaning. W stands for warmth, A for acceptance,
yes.
G for genuineness, and E for empathy.
Mm-hmm.
It means every counselor...
All four qualities must be there.
Four qualities must be there. These are the important qualities or traits required for a open distance teacher. Let it be university headquarter teacher or the counselor at the study center, mm-hmm. or coordinator. Whenever a student comes, we must welcome warmly.
Yes.
We must be warm enough to entertain, to engage the student, to give the information, etc. So, the next important thing is that they must accept,
exactly.
accepting the students. They should not feel that the students are wasting my time or I am busy kind of, no, that is not the approach. They must accept. Third is they must be genuine.
Yes.
If a student comes for some career guidance, some placement service or some general information, some personal difficulty, genuine advice is important. Genuineness.
Yes.
And all the more important is the fourth quality, empathy. Is the counselor must be in a position to place himself in the place of the student.
Exactly.
In the place of the learner. If I am in his place, or if I am in her place, what should be I feeling? What should I be feeling?
Yes.
This kind of empathizing quality, then they can do wonderful job as counselors. And learners can be motivated.
Yes.
Learners need to be motivated because that is not, our learners are not homogeneous. They are heterogeneous group in terms of diverse backgrounds, economic, social, and also educational background. And age-wise, demographic feature is that age composition. And hence, they need diverse need support.
Now, yesterday in our informal discussion regarding UK Open University, that the role of the counselors and the teachers, he told me that the teachers wait for the telephonic conversation with the learners for about 2 hours, they are available. So, this system...
It's like this, in UK Open University, there is what is called tele-tutorial system.
Yes.
Every teacher is asked to be made, asked to make himself available at a given time, and there is a telephonic call coming from the student. And there was about 20-25 students would be allotted to each teacher.
Yes.
And that particular topic will be given, the students will call and where the teacher will counsel.
Mm-hmm.
It means that the teacher is available during that slot of time to meet the requirements of the students, to clarify the doubts.
Yes.
That kind of system is there. We can also have that kind of system, but here, it may sound to be very expensive a proposition at this stage.
No,
but
what we have done it this year, in this year perspective.
Telephonic expenses, the charges towards telephones have come down.
Now we
can think of that also.
Yes.
We can think of that also.
Now what we are doing this year, that we have in the prospectus, we have given the email ID of all the faculty members, all the 35 faculty members, and saying that the learners can contact the faculty members through internet anytime, and I have instructed the faculty members that within 48 hours, whatever the question asked by the learners through internet must be answered, academic questions.
Very good.
So, this is a system we are introducing. although it is not just like UK Open University system,
no,
but
no.
It's a pious attempt to make the learners, the counselors, as well as the teachers available to the service of the learners.
Correct. See, it's like this. In a way, this is a better proposition than even tele-tutorials. Tele-tutorials, there is a time slot given and students ought to call.
Yes.
But now, students can send in a mail anytime they want. And in less than 48 hours, the response goes. This is more an advantageous kind of system. You have initiated the...
Only thing is that from the learner's side, they must use the internet. That's... And these cafes are available.
No. See, the students may not be having...
Everybody may not be having
internet and laptop at home. But I think every place is having a cyber cafe.
Yes.
They can do it. At least 75% of the students at this stage will be able to... take advantage of this.
Now, moreover, for each of the blocks of Assam, that there is a free internet services given by the state government.
Uh-huh.
So, student can go to the block office and use the internet service. So, that's a great opportunity.
If there is a will, there is a way.
Exactly.
Students can definitely make use of it. And whenever we introduce some new technology, we think students may not be able to cope with it. Our experience is, if we introduce, they are the better users and they adapt themselves to the requirements.
Yes.
Now, for example, the ICR technology is used. Originally, when we introduced in any university, we were thinking, will they be able to
use it?
But now they are wonderfully using it. They know how to use the technology and we are able to give a better service to the students.
Yes. So, finally, I am taking a lot of time for your very busy schedule in the university. So, basically, this time we have come to the university to... as an external verifier for the Commonwealth of Learning CallRIM, that review and in information, that improvement model. Now, can you just enlighten, because we know this, that can you enlighten the learners and the counselors regarding the CallRIM and what is the advantages of CallRIM, how the university will get the advantage to improve the quality of education? Can you just enlighten with it?
CallRIM is a quality assessment manual and process. Commonwealth of CallRIM refers to Commonwealth of Learning Review and Improvement Model.
Yes.
And they have introduced this model about 2 years ago. And very few institutions got quality mark and quality verified by the CallRIM. And Commonwealth of Learning is helping the open education institutions to enable themselves to make an assessment of their own performance.
Yes.
In terms of the quality education that they are able to provide. And there is a procedure, the manual describes the step-by-step process comprising about 7 steps. And I congratulate the Vice Chancellor of Krishnakant Handik State Open University for voluntarily inviting this in the first stage itself, in the first instance, to accept the quality assessment by the COAL. And COAL has sent me as an external expert, and I've been helping the university for the past 6 months. And in March I came once, and now I came. And my understanding is that in a span of 7 years of experience, the university is doing a very good job. That they are very strong in many fronts, and there are certain limitations because of the age of the university, because of the resources constraint.
Yes.
But they will be overcome as we progress in the direction of the development. And this is a public funded university which will definitely develop in multi-dimensional way, and the quality is very good as of now considering the experience. And the quality is said to be high, particularly in the teaching learning front, development of multimedia at the headquarters and making it available through internet and all that, YouTube, and these kinds of measures are there. But infrastructure side, there is a need, but anyway, because of the small age, it will take some time. But otherwise, university is doing wonderful job. My greetings and congratulations to the university. And particularly, I congratulate Vice Chancellor for initiating CallRIM exercise at this stage. Even in India, not more than 4 universities have been done so far.
Mm-hmm. So actually, we are coming to the close of this discussion. So what on behalf of the university, I thank you not only for being with us for the two times, but for guiding this university to improve the quality of ODL education. And this will definitely greatly help this university to march ahead with the great universities, open universities of the country, as well as the global open universities. No. So thank you very much, Professor.
It is my pleasure. Yes. I feel very homely here, and then I am really enjoying my stay, and the hospitality and fraternity and friendship of the Vice Chancellor and senior officers and young and vibrant faculty of this university and non-teaching staff. Yes. I am grateful to you for this opportunity.
Yes, thank you very much.
Nice. Pleasure, sir.